That's a pretty bright light. That's going to go off. Whatever.
All right. No, you guys can find the lights. All right. How you guys doing?
Doing well?
All right.
Doing good.
Stick up that energy level a little bit. All right. I did have a Red Bull this morning. I might need one, but we'll see how it's going. All right. So, show of hands. Who has actually heard of Ember.js? Awesome. That's almost all of you. That's really cool. All right. Who's actually used it? Okay, we're getting smaller percentages. All right. And then, cool, you'll be all using it up. So, who am I? Husband, father, triathlete, full stack guy, Ruby on Rails right now. I dabble in a little JavaScript, and I get stuff done, so I don't have time for the small stuff. So I want conventions over a configuration, and Ember is definitely takes that place. So, takeaways for today. What are you going to try to come away from this talk with? Why choose Ember? Ember is better than other things, in my opinion. And I'll try here to tell you why. Different parts of it. What makes up Ember? There's different components, and touch base there. And why you should use Ember at work? Yeah, that's really one of the tough sells, right? You can work 9 to 5 and say, okay, well, how do you bring it into the workplace? Hopefully, I have some tips and tricks for you to slide that in. Starting off, why choose Ember? Well, because React. Mainly in there. So I took a gander at React for a little bit, tried wrapping my hand around it, and I just felt weird. I felt wrong putting in HTML just right into my JavaScript. It just, we're going backwards. So I'm not going to get to React. React's a great library that will work for situational use. I just don't see it as a big full solution. Well, how about Backbone? I went on Backbone. I said, all right, I need a template example. And I said, all right, well, you have a model, and you have the URL path. You have the routes actually in this. And this was an example. Class post has all the... So we'll talk about some of the things about Backbone. PHP, I know it's not really a JavaScript library, but it shares the same convoluted putting functions and business logic into your application. This is actually a real WordPress theme that I got a headache looking at the picture while creating the slide. I'm not kidding. So I'm not available for PHP consulting. So I have done it before, and I'm not available. I'm glad Ember's here. So, all right, so fine. What is Ember? Ember's awesome. I'm taking a stance. I'm going to say it's pretty sweet. And I'm open to feedback, as you can say. Here's a standard definition. It's an open source framework based on the MVC pattern. It allows to create single page apps using common idioms and conventions. It removes the decision and the thought to where you structure your application, how you structure it, and so Ember is not a library. It's a full JavaScript framework that provides you routing, components, models. We'll dive into those. Ember is not going to break in a few months. And so it's actually maintained with backwards compatibility in mind using semantic versioning. If you guys don't know semantic versioning, semver.org is a fantastic way to do it. And Ember is not wishy-washy. It is a strong-lined, opinionated framework that takes a lot of that decision-making out. So I thought a better way to talk about cool things is to show cool things. So we're going to do a quick dive into this. And that is a fantastically small resolution, but hopefully it'll work for you guys. All right, so this is the Ember.js homepage. It's straight up right on the main drag. And this is a little application that has some handlebars. We'll dive into what handlebars is in a minute. And this is a name. Enter your name. All right, so my name is Ryan, and I want to learn Ember. There is a dynamic binding right there, and it's 4 lines of code. So here's a cool little example of a little mini Ember app right on the homepage. It's a generic email inbox. So we have inbox, we have different spam folders. Notice how the URL is changing right up here. So let's go into our inbox. Welcome to Ember. And now we're actually in that RESTful style endpoint. We have looking at that email from Conf. And there's more resources. So
just a quick little demo if you guys want to play with that.
What's included when you download Ember? There's the Ember main framework. It's minified. There's a fantastic release schedule. Every 6 weeks, they're trying to release another version. They actually do provide patches backboarding. Handlebars. Handlebars is a templating language that is similar to Mustache. It provides a logicless templating language for your HTML, and it includes jQuery. jQuery is pretty much ubiquitous nowadays. Why is it included ever? jQuery is used for inserting and modifying DOM elements. By having a standard DOM manipulation library in jQuery, developers can move between Ember apps and rely on the fact that they have a battle-tested cross-platform library underneath them. And then the QUnit is a testing framework that is included in Ember. What's not in the box, but actually should be? It makes sense to keep them separated, but it also makes sense to put them together. Ember Data and Ember CLI. Ember Data is a robust library for modeling data that's designed to be agnostic to the underlying persistence mechanism. So it works just as well with JSON APIs or HTTP as it does with streaming web sockets or local indexed DB storage. It provides many of the facilities you find in server ORMs, like Rails Active Record, but is designed specifically for JavaScript in the browser. In particular, Ember Data uses A+ compatible promises from the ground up to manage loading and saving records. Essentially, if you actually want to do something that's important, use Ember Data. Really, it's really cool. It adds a has-made belongs to relationship. That is really nice when you have sub records and loading those records deep down. It also allows you to get to a store class. So if you were to make a request out to a web service, you can actually save the data into that local store, and then you don't have to make that subsequent request to that store. We'll dive into that a little bit later. Ember CLI. Ember CLI is a really, really almost essential required piece of add-on right now. It's a command line interface for actually helping you create your apps quickly and efficiently. This has so many features. I might need two slides for this. We have a asset pipeline, and it has a project structure, which is tells you models go into your models folder, controls go into controllers folders. It gives you a convention of how you should name your files, and it just really tightens things up so you don't have to worry about those things. It has a live development server, so it's similar to Grunt and Gulp and live reloading, so you can actually make changes side by side, Windows pops up, and you have instant code changes. And you have a generated blueprints. So if you were to say, oh, I need a new model, Ember generate model user, and boom, you have a user and its template, adds everything into that front folder structure, similar to Rails. And then there's a different way to create a component. Ember G is generate. So here's just a couple other things that Ember CLI can do. Fingerprinting, adding on a unique GUID to all your assets when you deploy those out, allows minification as well. So everyone needs those. Production ready JavaScript code. Deployment, API stubbing, version control, SAS, package management, CI, CD. Just there's so many things you can do with Ember CLI, and we'll touch with base about add-ons. So, yeah, I'm actually going to do a demo. All right, so. So this is a demo app that I created for you guys and for the community. It's a completely Ember 2.0 compliant application. And one of the reasons why I really specified Ember 2, I'm glad they released in August, so I had to prepare my application at the same time they were going live with Ember 2.0. Let me pause real quick and talk about Ember versioning. It's really important. You'll have Ember 1.11, 1.12, 1.13. Ember 1.13 was the last release before the 2.0 branch. So in order to be Ember 2.0 compliant, you could actually have your Ember 2.0 compliant in Ember version 1.13. So as they went up the chain, they actually were adding more features in the 2.0, and they just turned on deprecation warnings. So in 1.13, they added, I believe, views were going to be deprecated. And so you get the deprecation message in your Ember inspector, which is just based soon. And then as you get to 2.0, it actually will turn off those all, and it'll, your app will start breaking. So if you know, where you upgrade to. So I think it's one of the most fantastic upgrading strategies that there are. So this is a race app. Let's say you're doing a half marathon and want to see how your athletes are doing. And every name is to athletes because I'm a technical guy. And so we have races. Let's click on races. And this is actually hosted. You guys can hit this. I'll supply some of the GitHub code. And please feel free to play with this. This is actually using Firebase, which is a database as a service. Actually pulls down all that. There's two lines that connect it to Firebase, and we'll go from there. Kind of partial to Boston Marathon, so with marathon's 26 miles, it's 13 miles, but you get the idea. So we have races, and we have a unique ID. Boston Marathon, and we have a couple buttons up here. Start race, start fast race, and then reset race. So right now they're all sorted by default, by age, and then by 5K pace. So this is a 5K pace is a 3.1 mile race that you kind of average out your times. And I use that as a helper to kind of generate random numbers if they were running an actual marathon. You can take a look at the actual math that's in the application. So let's just scroll over here. We got 13, we got the total time on the side. So we'll start a fast race real quick and just kind of see the people running really fast, really fast. Let's see if it finishes. Nope. All right. Well, this is a weird bug, but you guys can play with it, figure it out. So you can actually have, that's it. Yeah, homework. Open a pull request too. That'd be great. So we have, let's see, Serena did pretty well, 135. We can sort by different, all these kind of things. And we're actually doing, we're actually modifying the array that's holding all of that data. Dynamically doing it. You can sort by age, and my favorite is Debbie, man. Debbie's 59 years old, but she runs at 6:30.
That's fantastic.
So, all right. Let's dive on over to, let's see, Anderson here. And this is the user's route, standard type of red style, and you have details about that Anderson zip code. And in here, we have the that Ember data relationship, the users.race. User.race, and you can jump back and forth between those guys. So, alright, parts of Ember. Well, you saw a lot of cool things. What was it made of? Routes, models, components, and templates. So, essentially, these are main kind of building blocks. We have a couple other ones I'll touch base on, but these are the ones important for Ember 2.0 going forward. Routes. In Ember.js, each of the possible states in your app are represented by a URL. We can easily answer, are we logged in? What are we looking at? These are encapsulated by route handlers for the URL. At any given time, your application has one or more active route handlers. These active handlers can change for one of two reasons. Number one, the user interacted with a component, which generated an event which caused the URL to change. Or number two, the user changed the URL manually, example by the back button, or the page loaded for the first time. So one of the big concepts of Ember is that it is essentially URL driven, and based on the URL is the state of your application. One of the important parts of routes is that it actually will take the data and get that data for all the requests. So this is where this routes are where the actual data is happens. And here's some example routes. Alright, so since Ember, this is a CoffeeScript, and here's an example of router file. We have the top level users on the guys over on the side using a green laser pointer on this side. We have a users route, which has a user path underneath it. And there's a lot of convention happening here that's under the covers that you don't have to take care of. For example, you don't specify an index route, it actually will automatically generate an index route. So users, actually right in here, there's an index route that's, if you don't have it, just automatically generated. You don't have to override it. The path of users, if you guys see here right here, it's actually missing a path. Well, if it's the same as the route name, that's what it uses. So the convention really allows you to really dry up your code. So one of the big parts is data down. So routes actually take all that data from the top level and send it down to the controllers and just go into the views. And then the other part is having actions bubble up. So if you have a button on a page and you actually will send that event up the chain, and until a route an actual handler handles that and then does something with that action. So it can go all the way up to the top of the application, or it can be handled down all the way in that component level. It's really up to where you want to declare that. So we have typical MVC versus MC, I like to call, but it's actually just models and components. So we have a couple other parts. Components do have different parts of it. We'll touch base on what that is. I think that MVC pattern is starting to get morphed. It's kind of amphibious now. It's changing. So we'll dive into what components are. Components are a JavaScript file that has JavaScript logic and actually an accompanying handlebars file. They are isolated by design, and they're not aware of their surroundings. So any context that you need, you actually need to pass that in to that component. So as you saw that there was a users list, and that was a component. So it didn't actually have any data in that component. It didn't make any calls in that. And we actually call that component, and we send the data into it. Components require a dash in the name, because if you were to create a B component, for example, you'd override the bold tag, and you probably don't want to do that. That can give you a lot of power. It's not a good idea to shoot yourself in the foot. So they require a dash name. It's actually faster for Ember to dive down and find which components are there. So here's an example component. I cut up some of the example code. You can add properties like a standard object. This CoffeeScript is 1 through 13, so it actually is an array of 13 integers. A couple of Booleans, an array of assorted properties. We have a standard action, a sort age. So when you click on that little tilt, that little up down arrow, that will actually trigger this action. Since we're in the component, we want to bubble up the actions, but we'll handle that action right in that component. So we're setting the set sort properties, which is set up here. We'll set it to age, do a little interpolation, sort by description, and we'll send sort description is up here. Send it a property, if property, blank, otherwise, a description. That the sort properties is an Ember property, Ember native. And then the arrange content here is a holdover from the old sorting. Controllers used to be able to have an arrange content sort type. That got phased out in Ember 2.0. And now I just named it just for brevity. It's actually a computed property. And computed properties are pretty cool. Actually, we'll go ahead and do lots of work based on different properties, the content, the sort properties. We'll actually do all that sorting for you. The sort properties in that array. So here's an example of Ember's website with the component. It has a property of size, email, gravatar image. and then just dump in your image, and it'll actually automatically grab that. Pretty basic URL here, right? It's avatar, returns the email in an MD5 hash. You jump around to the actual application. It has two Gravatar images components with an email defaulting to Thomaster. And then the actual component HTML handlebars, I apologize, is the source of the Gravatar URL, which is that property. So let's talk about models. So here's a ES6 example of a copy scripted model. It's first name, last name. The model is a class that defines the properties and behavior of the data that you present to the user. Anything that the user expects to see if they leave your app and come back later, or if they refresh the page, should be represented by a model. So we have the first name, last name, and full name. So I want to talk about this computed property. It will actually take a listen on the first name property, a listen on the last name property, and actually you send the function take gets those properties, adds a string, empty string, and then returns that as a full name. Really powerful. So if you were, as you put my name in there, automatically will handle that for you. Here's another example of a CoffeeScript race model. We're actually metaing up the attributes, the adders here. By default, since convention wins in this case, if it's a string, it's a string, it's a boolean. So if you want to be more explicit, you can actually set those here. Being a little fancy there. And then the really important thing here is that the has many users. That's really important to set that relationship. And Ember will take care of a lot of that. Ember did. As I said, I love computed properties. It makes things really, really slick. Serializers and adapters is how to modify your code, how to get your code. So that's kind of an advanced topic. I'll touch base if you want to touch on that. Models can be anything you want. You can be arrays, hashes, you can be other models, you can be a plain old JavaScript object. It's pretty straightforward. So let's slide over to templates. What is a template? It's Ember.js uses a handlebars template library to power up your app's user interface. Handlebars templates are just like regular HTML, but they also give you the ability to embed expressions that change what is displayed. So if you were to modify that model anywhere else on that page, it would instantly be changing that full name, age, etc. In the middle here, around this TD, we have a link to. This is the standard ahref concept, similar to Rails and how they have their link to. You pass it the race, that's actually the route, the model race ID, the idea of that race, and then we give it the name of the race name and the link to. There is a shorter syntax for that link to. I put it in the code so you can kind of see some different examples. And a basic no logic loop. So each users comes in as an array of users. You spin through each one as a user, user.age. There's a cool little hand helper that if there is no users, it dumps out an empty row saying users. So you'll see what, in going around, you'll see lots of controllers. You still can use controllers. They're faded away to routable components. Right now, routes send to controllers. Components are kind of isolated as by design. They're going to be in there's an RFC in the Ember, and that will allow you to route to components specifically, so they'll decommission controllers. So making those should be auto-generated. Again, convention wins. Kind of pound that point home. If you don't add a controller, it will automatically add one for you. There's nothing really fancy there. They're singletons, so they actually will save that state across pages. And sometimes that's good, sometimes that's bad. We'll see how it goes. I call them just decorators. For instance, if you had that full name, you could have added that to the user controller instead. I'd add it to the user model, because eventually we're going to phase out controllers. This is a pretty boring slide, so I thought to spice it up a little bit. I'm just amazed. I don't know how it does it. I'm going to try that tomorrow. We'll see how it goes. It's my wife's going to have it. So helpers. Helpers are a little Ember add-on that help the presentation. Pretty standard, nothing too fancy. Ember generate helper. We'll grab and call format currency. So your handlebars template would be a format currency of 250, and the output would be $2.50. Really lightweight, not to have any crazy amount of logic, just to present presentation on it. Add-ons are really powerful. There's some Rails gems, and so that they are extensible. There's tons of websites out there that help you out find the best ones. Bootstrap, Ember CLI, deploys, anything you want to do, we can make it an add-on. So parts of Ember: routes, components, models, templates, a little bit of controllers, a little bit of helpers, and add-ons. Those are really the core concepts. So how do you use Ember at work? That's the hard part, right? This is a really cool language. How do you sell it to your boss? Teamwork. That's how you sell it to your boss. So let's say you were to jump from I had an Ember application, and I jumped to another Ember application. There's no learning curve. I know how the property is structured. I know how it works. I know how to deploy it. I put it into it. Backbone, not so much. Let's put your models over here. Let's put your models over here. So every team can be different. You have to learn the whole application over again. And there's no similarity between the projects. So that's one of the great things about Marionette. Marionette is bringing that convention into Backbone. And Lindsay has a great talk about how that works. So what does this desk look like? Is it first, I mean, just anybody, person just pop in your head? What's this desk? Anything related to it? For me, it looks like a designer's desk. Nice and clean, smooth, IKEA furniture. Not really much going on with it. But I call it a designer desk, right? Nice and simple. So how do you work with designers? Let's say the UX team gave you a giant HTML rendering of your page. And you have to make it an Ember. Well, you replace a couple for loops, you throw a couple of dynamic properties in, you're good to go. There's no logic in your presentation. Or vice versa, it's really helpful to say, all right, well, here's my loops, here's my presentation layer, send it off to designers, they stick in their HTML, there's no convoluting that. All right, let's talk about Angular. All right, so, imagine going up to your boss and say, all right, well, I'm going to work on this project for 6 months. I'm going to spend all this dev time, all this work into it, and then a couple months, it's going to change. I have to rewrite the whole thing all over again. No backwards compatibility. I can't sell that. I can't, in good faith, say, oh, this is going to be a good project to work on. There's definitely some pros and cons. You have to play those out. You'll learn those by working on it. Number one, it's also owned by Google. That's good and bad. Google's a big company, has a good work behind it, but also, have you heard of Adobe Flex? Yahoo UI, Microsoft Silverlight, I can keep going on and on. Ember is not owned by a corporation, it's backed by big companies. They use it in big companies. I believe iTunes just came out, and that's Ember app. So one of the cool things you can actually find out what an Ember app is an Ember tab and Chrome extension. We'll talk about that in a little bit. Community is really strong. I've never really felt this with any other language, C#, Ruby, Rails. I really haven't felt that. There's definitely some really cool things. For instance, they have meetups all over the world. Meetup down in Boston. You're able to talk to some of the guys who are on the core team. I asked a question at one of the meetups. So Ember data is at 027. And then Ember is at 112, 111. I was like, so what was there was a disconnect? Aren't they going to be going out the same release cycle? And one of the guys on the core team said, yeah, they're going steady. We're working on getting that up to the same versioning scheme, and that way they can go hand in hand. So another problem I had was I had a 1x application. I think it was 111, 112. Trying to get that up to 2.0, and I had this really interesting problem where I couldn't get this page to load correctly. Send the content. I hopped on the Slack member group and was talking to the Ember data group and said, hey, I have this question about this context, paste a little snippet of code, and and one of the maintainers of the application was in there, and he said, oh, have you tried this, context dot whatever? Okay, tried it out, and it worked fine. So in 2 minutes, I was able to solve my bug I was working on for an hour. So hey guys, our community is fun. We've got a cool logo. Well, there's also, Conf, Conf, Seattle, Conf. Kind of also that one. Denver, Tomster, and it's a serious but fun kind of connotation. Definitely at production level, scalable and stable, but it still has a fun concept to it. It's not hard to work on a standard thing. So we have some guys' opinion of where Ember lands and kind of the state of frameworks and. 2014, 2015, and I know it's a little bit small, I apologize, but if I glue up any figure, it looked awful. So on the left-hand side, we have the just released kind of projects we have, and then the y-axis, we have the slowed, the innovation. And so Backbone and Google Web Tools is kind of not innovating quite aggressively, knockout.js. And then over in the top left, we have the hotness of React. It's hot, but it's innovating. But Ember's figured out that that the virtual DOM diffing is really, really important, and that's really to get really fast apps. So in 1.13, Ember released the Glimmer engine. It's a complete rewrite of views. And so, as in React, there's a virtual DOM, and it actually changes and views the DOM next to each other. One differentiating aspect the Glimmer engine has in Ember is it adds a dirty tag onto that property. So if you compare those DOM diffs, you don't actually have to navigate the entire DOM. You actually will just flow down the DOM, find the ones that are dirty, compare those, and diff those in as well. So why use Ember at work? Teamwork, designers, community, stable, easy to use, and has a giant asterisk. There is a learning curve on that. And that's why I'm here to help you. I'm here to show you all those cool things you can do with it. And believe me, I'm more than happy to help answer any questions. So it's really hard. It's pretty hard to get started. But once you get it, it's really fast. There's really smooth sailing. So here's the cool parts. I definitely have time for it because I talk too fast. So everybody is talking about isomorphic JavaScript. Can you run JavaScript on the server side? Make that first response fast? Yes, you can. There's a project called Fastboot, headed by Tom Dale, one of the maintainers. It's an Ember CLI add-on. And there are some stipulations, but it doesn't allow you to have the DOM, so you can't run jQuery, you can't run any sort of manipulation on that. It's essentially for web searches, indexing, getting that first page reaction time really, really fast. It's working. I think it's alpha beta, but it's pretty promising. So we have pods, not those pods, but anyway, worth a shot. After some Star Wars in there. We have the pods. So pods are a structure of your files. So right now, let's say you have an object called pickle. I want to use pickle because it sounds funny. So we have controllers, pickle, routes, models, they're all over the place, but have the same name. So it's kind of easy for, at least I use RubyMine, so it's easy to kind of find all the things I need to pickle, and then jump into the one that's the appropriate one. If that starts getting a large project, you start adding cucumbers and squash and apples and oranges, you start adding a gigantic folder. And so pods allow you to take that name and kind of put all those files into one place, controller, routes, models. You don't have to have all those files. Sometimes they're auto-generated based on convention. So there actually is a pickle.js if you're interested. So say no to 2013. So you guys will go and say, oh man, I'm stuck in this problem. You look at a Stack Overflow question, you're like, oh man, that's 2013. Shouldn't look up. Ember has graduated so far in 2 years that look for 2014 or greater. So this is kind of a complicated slide, but this is kind of out of the left field. This is how the data comes down into the application.
as I mentioned, the store before in the routes. So Ember is based on the routes. So if you were to do slash races, it would say, okay, well, go find me all those races in the local HTML store. All right, they're not there. Okay, use an adapter to modify that request. Say, go out to that REST service, go out to that JSON API service, SOAP service if you're so inclined, and then use AJAX requests to send that off into that service and send it back. And then it sends back as promises, so that way you can chain those, you can have a really snappy web in front end, and then fill that data in as needed. So one of the big parts is the Ember Inspector. So we'll dive into this as a quick example, but it's on GitHub. You actually can push to it as an open source project, and it's available as a Chrome extension. And actually, we'll dive down what your application is. You can actually see all the routes, the data, the models, all within the browser. So here's some cool resources. I put the guide to Ember right on the top page. It's fantastic. Fantastic community to keep that website up to date with examples. And it's essentially, if you have a question about Ember, it's usually on that page. And if it's not, there's other places like Discuss and Slack, and et cetera. The Ember Weekly meeting list is a pretty cool way to keep up to date on what version is coming up and what new things are coming up. So let me slide on over real quick to that Firebase app that we're playing with. So let's dive into that races Boston Marathon. And let's see if this works on the big screen. So we actually can see the whole view. And you can see application as the base, races, race. Dive into the model itself. So they click on model, you can see all the properties of that model. You can see different properties in it. A lot of these are handled by Ember. This little calculator means it's a computed property. And you can dive into the routes themselves. You can see all the routes that Ember does. And all of these are all handled by convention. I don't touch any of those. I could override that loading screen, make it nice and smooth. Data. Actually shows you all the data that you have in your application and all the users, 300 users. You guys can play with that.
Hey guys, we have 5 minutes. Do we have questions?
Yep, and that's it. Last slide.
Awesome.
Thanks, guys. Questions?
Hi, thanks a lot for the talk. So the way I understand it, Ember is used traditionally for single page apps. Are there ways to incrementally add Ember to an existing app?
I don't have experience doing that, so I can't answer that one. But what we're doing on a project that I'm working on, we're actually doing it side by side. We're actually using the same back end, and we have the current interface on one side. And we're actually able to stand up another Ember app that's pointing the same data source. So that's how we kind of do it side by side.
Excellent. I had a couple syntax questions. I saw at signs in there in arrows. Dash greater than. Is that ES6 or is that CoffeeScript?
That's CoffeeScript.
Okay, that's called.
Yep. I just jotted back here before you.
Yeah,
so,
exactly.
Yep, this is a CoffeeScript. So this is a function. Open greater than. At is a this dot, so you get the context of, so that way you can kind of trim up your code. You can optionally put it in parentheses if you want. It's CoffeeScript. You don't have to use CoffeeScript. That's just I more preference for it.
Thanks.
All right.
Ryan, great job.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks for coming, everyone.